like a gun.
Hello and welcome to People of Paradise. I'm Shirley and this is Lynda.
Hi everybody.
And on the show today, we have Graham Clark from Brilleaux fame.
We interviewed Graham at Toto Street, a very well-known music venue. Very interesting interview. I'm sure everybody will enjoy it.
And Graham, of course, is as well as being a great harmonica player, songwriter and singer, with the band Brilleaux, and of course they've toured UK quite a few times. But Graham has many stories, interesting stories to tell us, and he's also written a book, The Right Note, and he's owned his own bar in the past, so a very interesting man indeed.
And didn't he write that other book about...
Yes, he's also written one about Richie Packard
that's
as well.
Right, yes.
And possibly another book in the offing too, but we'll find out more about that on the show. So without further ado, Graham Clark.
Welcome to the show. We've got Graham Clark on the show today.
Thank you, Shirley.
Come
nice
all the
to
way.
Be here.
Thank you. Yeah, all the way over from Hawke's Bay.
Hawke's Bay, yes, bit of a trip.
Yeah, and how's it all going over there for you?
Wonderful. We're thoroughly enjoying our new lifestyle.
Yeah, oh, that's
down
great.
There in the Hawke's Bay, yep. The other bay.
That's great. And what have you come up for today? Well, at least yesterday, wasn't it?
Yeah. Yes, Brilleaux are playing support act for a David Bowie tribute show with a chap from America who he has been in television ads and everything actually,
yep,
with David Bowie as
wow,
playing his double, as he looks
so like him and sounds like him, I presume.
Yes, well, we'll find out. He, you know, to be contracted by David Bowie,
exactly,
he must have been fairly convincing double.
I wonder if we could get to speak to David Bowie's double today.
Yes, well, yes, that's a good idea.
It is a good idea. Yeah. What's his name, by the way?
I can't remember.
No.
David something or other.
Not
Bowie.
Not David Bowie.
No, not David. No, I can't recall, actually. I'm sorry.
No. Okay, so getting back to you anyway. So, obviously, you're here with Brilleaux. Before we talk about Brilleaux, Brilleaux is Graham's band, of course. You were born in England, is that correct?
Yes, I was born in England, and my parents emigrated to New Zealand in 1969.
Yes, so England coming to New Zealand. Now, I did hear a story that you actually lived with Shane Hales, is that? Not lived with Shane Hales, sorry, lived in his house.
Yes, it was quite a coincidence that Shane lived in a council house in Guildford, Surrey. And when his parents decided to emigrate to New Zealand,
yeah,
so they vacated the house and emigrated to New Zealand, and my family moved into that house,
right,
that council house.
Yeah, yeah.
So my bedroom was actually Shane Hale's bedroom.
Amazing,
eh? It's quite quite a coincidence.
Quite a coincidence.
And then then 10 years later,
yeah,
my parents decided to emigrate to New Zealand, and in that 10 years, Shane had become a huge New Zealand,
exactly,
pop star.
Yeah, of course.
Probably New Zealand's first real pop star.
Mm.
And some 20 years later, I decided to become a musician as well. And so I ended up becoming a musician or an entertainer.
So can I ask, what did this bedroom look like?
Just a two up, two down, very basic bedroom, nothing in particular, but there must have been the vibrations of the music that Shane listened to in the walls that inspired me to become a musician.
Which actually brings me to my next question. What drew you to music apart from Shane in the house?
What
drew you into coming to music, do you think? What was that influenced you?
I was living in Tauranga and I just arrived here from an OE to England. And I met up with some guys and they said, we're going to the pub tonight to see a band. Do you want to come?
Mm.
And I'd never actually seen a band in a pub before.
Yeah.
I'd seen lots of, you know, Pink Floyd,
yeah,
and
yeah,
the Stones and all kinds of people at big places in England. But I'd never actually been to a pub and seen a band.
Yeah.
And I was 24 years old.
Right.
Anyway, we went to the Blue Room in Tauranga, and there was a band playing there called Every Mother's Son, who had a whole bunch of very clever local musicians. And I was mesmerised watching this band. The singer's name was Dean Ronalds, who was a local Tauranga guy. And he had this huge crowd packed wall to wall in this bar. He had the whole crowd in the palm of his hand.
Wow.
And I went, wow,
yeah.
I want to do that.
Yeah.
I want to. But I'd never sung in my life before. So the guys that I went to the show with, they said, oh, well, I've got a drum kit. And one said, I'm a bass player, so let's have a jam. I didn't know what a jam was, but I was up for it.
Yeah.
I was up for anything in those days. And so we had a jam, and I started singing, and they were quite surprised.
Oh, yeah.
And we eventually decided to form a band.
Yeah.
And...
what was the name of the band?
Mixed Vegetables.
And of course you had a band called Electric Soup.
I did have
sort
a band
along the same yes. lines.
Were you vegetarians?
What sort of soup was it?
Well, anyway, so this Mixed Vegetables, it was just a bunch of guys having a jam. And then we decided that we wanted to play and get paid. So we approached a local Chinese restaurant at 11th Avenue and said we were this experienced band and would they like a band to play in the...
Yeah, yeah.
And they said yes, they'd have us. So we learned how to set up a PA and and we learned a whole set night's worth of cabaret material.
Oh, okay.
Because I didn't want to play in the pub because we didn't know what we were doing.
Yeah.
We thought we'll get into it slowly. And so we actually paid our dues and taught ourselves the ropes by playing cabaret music in a local Chinese restaurant.
Wow, that's something I didn't know.
Well, we did a good job.
Yeah.
And we got a bit more serious and decided we were going to play in a pub.
Yeah.
So we booked our first pub gig at the Saint Amand.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, I remember the Saint Amand.
Upstairs.
Yeah.
And we played our first pub gig in there. And it was really successful.
Yeah.
Well, for us anyway.
Yeah, yeah.
And so that just inspired us to continue and do more. That band, Mixed Vegetables, changed to a band called Beasley Street.
I know Beasley Street from then. Al Wallace.
That's right, Al Wallace.
Yeah, who else was on that band, was it?
Beano.
Yeah.
Beano.
Of course, Beano's hurt his leg.
He has, yes. He's out of action for a while. But anyway, and so Beasley Street went for 5 or 6 years and were very successful locally.
Yeah, yeah.
And sort of in the North Island. And yeah, we just got better and better.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And I was talking to Graham, because I was picking Graham Harlow for his brains last night, and he said was it something like the Gutter Brothers or something?
The Sensational Gutter Brothers.
I haven't heard of that one, I just thought I'd bring that one up.
That was another band.
There was another one, I suppose there's been quite a few, and of course now there's Brilleaux.
Yes. Brilleaux, I had been playing in covers bands since I decided to first sing and play. And then I sort of got sick of the scene, and you know, we had had such a vibrant music scene in Tauranga.
Right.
And then it sort of dwindled away, and it didn't have the camaraderie that it had in the sort of 80s. And I thought, oh, well, I'll stop playing.
Yeah.
So I stopped playing for a couple of years until I started to get the urge to play again.
Yeah.
And I thought, I want to do something different. I don't want to do the same thing that I had done before. There was a story in the Weekend Sun written by Winston Watusi, and it said he was sad that there were so many Tauranga covers bands and not many bands playing original material, because the quality of the musicians was good enough.
Yeah,
they just didn't have, they either didn't have the courage to do it, or they just wanted to play covers either. Mm-hmm. But, and I thought, I'll have a go at writing some original material and do an original band.
Yeah, yeah.
And I didn't want to start a band to be the same, in the same genre as everybody else.
Yeah.
Because you're competing with hundreds of other bands. I wanted to do something that
good
was
idea.
Unique.
Good idea, yeah.
And so I chose a variety of music that I was familiar with, that I liked. And I went around and handpicked a whole bunch of players and approached them.
And do you want to tell us about those players? Oh, yeah. On the band and what they play?
Well, Beano,
yeah.
Of course. Once you've had Beano as a drummer, you don't really need, you don't really, not inspired to go looking for another one.
But he's lovely too.
He's a legend on the drums. And so then there was another player, in, a guitar player in a covers band in town. His name was Kevin Nankerville.
Oh, okay.
He was just a young guy, about half of our age, but I liked his attitude and his style of playing. So I asked him, and there was a bass player who I had heard of, and so I just made up a tape of the genre of music, and I gave it to each of them.
Yep.
I said, this is what I want to play. Would you like to form a band? And they all said yes. And so then we started Brilleaux.
Yeah.
And Kevin and I started writing songs.
Right. Okay. Because Kevin, he wouldn't be in the band yet.
No, Kevin left after 18 months.
So who do you have in the band
now,
tonight?
He was replaced by Bruce Rollins.
Oh, Bruce. Yeah.
So Bruce is the guitar player and has been since Kevin, the original guitarist, left. And of course that means Bruce has been there for 19 years.
Wow,
so
that's a long time.
It is.
Yeah. And because we've got Brian Franks on bass now.
Brian Franks on bass, yeah.
And you bring in Tom Jolly in too, don't sometimes?
We do occasionally when we feel like having the luxury of having a keyboard player.
Yeah.
Tim is always keen to jump in.
Yeah, and are we missing anyone?
No, that's it. That's just us four.
And of course you play the harmonica.
Yes.
And you've got your lovely harmonicas here. Can you, before you, because I really like, if you play us a little tune.
A little tune.
But before you do, I was wondering if you could give me a little tip on how I could learn the harmonica, because I have a cat at home. I'll wait till
it's
finished. Linda's just getting that footage. I have a cat at home and he likes to scratch my face and actually bite my face whenever I pick up the harmonica, so I can't learn. So I'm just wondering if it's me or if I'm making cat noises on the harmonica and what I could do to perhaps.
Oh no, well my dog goes bonkers when I play the harmonica as
well.
Must
so
be the, something
just
to do
me.
With the frequency. Yeah, she howls and yodels away.
Mine actually jumps up on my face and bites me.
Wow.
Yeah. Put that harmonica down.
Yeah.
It's not very encouraging.
No. Well, they don't make a pleasant noise when you're learning to play, unfortunately.
No, they don't.
You just have to persevere, and,
and then
eventually the penny drops, you work out how it works.
Yeah. So would you like to play us a tune then?
So much.
What key is that one in?
That's a C.
That's a C, because all the harps have different keys.
They do,
yeah.
And that's part of the trick that
yeah.
you have to learn when you're playing harmonica. That it has to match the key of the
Yes.
Of the music.
Yeah.
You can't just pick up any old.
No. No. And my dad, he actually plays the harmonica.
Oh, good.
Yeah, but he doesn't do the blues one. He just does straight harmonica.
Yes.
And he loves it too.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's not too bad either. What better than me, anyway.
I was inspired to play it really by my grandfather. He used to play.
I was going to ask you what inspired you to play the harmonica.
Well, I used to hang around with my grandfather a lot, and he was a singer in pubs.
Yeah.
And he used to play the harmonica. And, but what inspired me was when we had Beasley Street, and the guys said, you know, they brought some songs to the table and said, let's learn this song. And it was a song I'd never heard before because I'd been overseas, and it was a song by an Australian band. And they said, we want to play this song. And I said, well, we can't do that. It's got harmonica in it. And they said, well, go and get a harmonica and work it out. So I went to Trevor, who had Mayer's musical centre, and I said, Trevor, we want to play this song. What key harmonica do I need?
Yeah.
And so he sold me the right harmonica for that song. And I went home and learned to play the song.
And of course, Trevor's so helpful.
He's an institution in the Tauranga area.
Exactly, music payment. And of course, you haven't just done writing of songs, which you've done a great job with, but you've also written other things as well. And I remember back when you lived in Tauranga, you actually used to write in the paper.
Yes.
Well, we won't go into that into too much detail, but I wondered if you could maybe sum up your experience in a couple of sentences of your writing in the paper. What would you say?
It blew my mind to realise the depth of the musical history that Tauranga had.
Right.
And it absolutely blew me away to think that so much talent had come out of this area that I didn't know about.
Yeah.
And that's really what inspired me to write the book.
Yeah.
I went to a chap, there was a drummer in town who actually used to fill in for us occasionally when Bino wasn't able to. And I went to his house one day, and there was this big picture on the wall of these five hairy looking hippies.
Yeah.
I said, who's that? And he said, oh, that's an old band I used to be in. And he started telling me about it, and my jaw dropped from the stories that he was telling me of who he was, and he was hanging out with Bruno Lawrence and Blurter.
Wow.
And,
you're not talking about Corbin, are you?
Yes, Corbin.
Yeah.
And all this just blew me away. So then he said, well, you've heard about Rob Smith, haven't you? I said, no. The Four Fours? No. Human Instinct? Ah, yes. Well, and then he started telling me the story of how the Human Instinct began back in the 1960s with Rob Smith and Trevor Spitz. And the things that that band achieved to become Human Instinct and sell thousands of albums. It just, I was flabbergasted. And that's really what inspired me to write a book and tell people about some of these things.
Yeah, and of course you've got the book there, it's called The Right Note. What are some of the more, all sorts of people in there, isn't there? Maybe name about 10 people of Hat who we could find out about in there? Obviously Human Instinct would be in there.
Yes. Well, Robbie Levin is in there, going back to the
Robbie.
Red Hot Peppers and Marion Arts.
Yep.
There is Morris Greer, Corbin Simpson, there's Richie Pickett.
Of course, I even saw Alan Wallace in there.
Alan Wallace, did I say Rob Smith, and Trevor Spitz, who formed the Four Fours and had the first music venue in town.
Yeah.
Alan Judd, who actually originated from Hamilton.
Right.
But, I think he was from here and he went to Hamilton and became a very well-known local venue owner and everything. But Alan was in local bands here. And there are so many.
And would you have a standout story in there? Or a standout interview?
I had so many amazing interviews. Mm. There was this old chap called Ken White. He was one of the very first originators of the Tauranga Jazz Festival. Mm. Mm. He was right there before it began. Mm. And him and Stan Farnsworth and Ken Heyman and these local jazz players started the Tauranga Jazz Festival. And Ken's story, I went up to his place up in the foothills of Minden early one day, and I didn't leave there till about 2 o'clock in the morning. And the wondrous stories that he just kept telling me, I just couldn't leave. It was like sitting down as a child and having mum read you a story, and you just listening to the fairy tales unravel.
Yeah.
So that was interesting.
You've got lots of pictures in there too. That must have cost a lot.
It cost a lot to produce the magazine, the book.
Yeah.
And that's why there won't be a reprint of it.
And you might be, and of course you've got a Richie Pickett one that you've done.
Yes, Richie Pickett was a local, a big fish in the musical industry around here. He inspired the music scene that we had here, which was the envy of the whole country, really. Him and Chris Gunn together. And Paul Higgins and things.
Yep.
Especially Richie and Chris, who had come here from, they had done that, played, they were just levels and levels above all the local bands. But they befriended us, those of us who they thought were worthy of their attention, thing.
Yeah.
If you didn't meet up to their expectations, then it could be pretty rude and sort of exclude you.
Yeah.
But those of us lucky enough sort of became part of this amazing scene that Tom had.
Yeah, yeah.
That, as I say, was the envy of the whole of New Zealand, really.
And any other books that you've got on the wings that you might do?
I thought I might write a companion to The Right Note.
Called The Right Note.
Yeah.
We should get that in.
More Right Notes.
Yeah, more Right Notes. Yeah.
Just because there are stories that are worth, that I missed out, just through simply not knowing about them.
And would they be historic? Would that be a historic book as well?
If somebody wants to write a song about the local, current local music scene, I'll leave that for them.
Yes. And there was this one question I was going to ask. I noticed that there was a lack of females on it, and I just wondered, is that because it was that there just weren't many females on the scene, or you didn't know many, or, you know?
No, my own experience at the time that I was in amongst the music scene, there were very, very few.
Yeah, I thought that would be the case. Yeah.
Sally, there was a girl, Sally something or other, who was a singer in an 80s covers band.
Yeah.
And then going back earlier to probably the 70s, there were the Olsen sisters, who were quite active in the country music scene.
Right.
This is what I kind of got into strife a bit with some local musicians who were upset that they weren't included in this book. But the reason for that is just because they thought they were musicians, it didn't mean that they actually contributed anything to the history. They didn't do anything special.
No.
They didn't do anything outstanding or original.
Mm.
Not that there was any original music at that time. So I wanted to reserve the book to people who actually made a difference or added something.
Mm.
They didn't just participate.
So maybe they could go in the...
Yes.
They could go in the wrong notes.
No, it's not...
Bum notes.
The bum notes. Yeah. No, it's not that they were bad or anything. It could have been, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
But I, particularly, the people in this book all contributed something memorable in one way or another. And so that's possibly why I left some of them out.
Well, it's actually a great thing that you've done, collecting that big piece of history and putting it on a book like that.
Oh, thank you.
It cost a lot of money and a lot of time.
I am very proud of it.
Oh, you should be.
And also just for the buzz that it gave me, meeting some of these people and getting them to tell me stories. You know?
It's like Lynda and me were doing it, and it's different to that obviously, but it's the same thing.
It's the same kind of thing. We're just capturing it on a different medium.
That's right, exactly.
Yeah. No, it's the same thing.
We're doing
a fraction of the price. So anyway, moving along, so talked about the book. I'll come back and talk about your UK tour as well. Remind me to talk about that. But I was going to talk about the Bar in the Park.
Bar in the Park, yes.
The bar that Graham used to own, when was that? Late 90s?
No, that was...
When was that?
I suppose it was. Mid-90s.
Mid-90s, right.
It was before the hub or the eating and dining...
That was a cool place.
...hub became on the Strand. Yeah. We were perhaps one of the very first trendy bars in town. Trendy as in...
It was trendy.
Not, they weren't just a booze bar. Mm. We offered craft beers. Mm. We offered table service.
Yeah.
We had waiters and waitresses serving people and selling drinks rather than waiting for people to come to the bar and buy them. We had really cool food as opposed to just having chips and stuff like that.
And you had those two flames that used to be on the
end. Oh, the flames.
They were pretty iconic, really, weren't they? They were.
I got into big trouble with those. Well, of course, there was nothing like that in Tauranga at that stage. Nobody had seen the likes
of them. You see them all the time, things like that now, but not back then.
No. And so it was my idea to put these gas flares up at the... We built these great big brick pillars from some the old bricks that were demolished from the old Tauranga Hotel. And we ran gas up into them. And we put into the council for a permit to have these gas flares. Well, you know, it was such an unusual thing back in those days that you can imagine the problem that you had trying to get something passed to council like that. Anyway, so we had the permit into the council waiting for them to approve it. And I was down at Bar in the Park, 2 o'clock in the morning, painting the ceiling. And I had this brilliant idea that seeing as there was nobody around and it was 2 o'clock in the morning, I thought nobody would notice and I'd go down. So I went up to the thing and I turned these gas flares on. Fired them up, these two big gas flares, and I walked across the road and admired my handiwork and how cool they looked. Anyway, so I left them going for 5-10 minutes and then I turned them off and I went back down under the thing and carried on painting the ceiling. The next thing, about 5 minutes later, there's a big bang on the window and I turned round and there was about five firemen standing in the courtyard with face masks and axes and oxygen bottles, looking in through the window. And somebody at the local pie cart up on Elizabeth Street had seen the flames and phoned 111 and said, Grey Street's on fire.
Oh, Jesus.
And...
You wouldn't have been too popular.
No. Well, it was lucky I knew the chief of police and I begged him not to file a report. And he gave me a warning, and I got off with that one, luckily enough.
You would have had quite a few bands through there, haven't you?
Hundreds and hundreds.
Yeah, you named about five of them?
Oh.
I mean, the Circus Animals.
Circus Animals,
they were a good band.
They were fantastic covers
band. Yeah, great band.
Yeah.
Hamilton, were they?
Yes.
The only one I remember.
The Gabriel Hounds, who were Irish music, made a huge... presence at that time, and everybody wanted to see Irish bands.
And the
Gabriel Hounds were just fantastic, brilliant musicians, put on a show, and there were these Irish jigs and reels, and great drinking music, and they used to sell the place out. Used to get packed.
And because I think who else was around in those days? I don't know if they played at the bar. Bar in the Park, wasn't it? Yeah. It's Park in the Bars in Auckland, isn't it?
It is, yes. It was a complete coincidence.
Yeah, funny.
Tauranga didn't have a garden bar.
Oh, yeah.
And the whole point of Bar in the Park was to have a garden bar. And that's where...
I didn't know.
That's where we brainstormed and came up with a bar in the park.
Because we would have had, the roadhouse would have been around that bay.
At the mount,
And Eddie Road.
Yes, Abbey Road.
Yeah,
that's right. That came along.
That was all before Mid City, wasn't it?
Yep.
Yeah, yeah.
Or at the same time, actually.
Was it about the same time? Oh, yeah.
I helped Peter and Diane actually put Abbey Road together. Mm. Or, in fact, 80% of the memorabilia in there on the walls was mine.
Abbey Road. Okay, so moving on, we'll go back to Brilleaux again.
Brilleaux, yes.
Talk about UK tours. How did that all go? I saw Bruce and Brian on the... Talking on live at one stage, or that was quite
fantastic. We have the time of our life at these doing these UK tours. We've just we completed our fourth tour in June this year, 2018. Yep. Yes, it's the ultimate for a band at the level that we are at to get to play overseas and play in the UK.
Did I read somewhere that you played, and I might have this wrong? Dr.
Feelgood?
Did you play with them or something?
Yes.
That must have been a dream for you.
Well, it was, because they were my...
I know.
They were the band that I modelled Brilleaux after.
Yeah,
and in fact, I named them after the lead singer.
Got to play with them.
Yes.
Yeah, wow.
That was actually at the Otamatai Trust Hotel.
Yeah.
They were doing a New Zealand tour, Southern Hemisphere tour. And I introduced myself to them before the show. Because
I saw them. That was in the UK.
This was
yeah, carry on.
Back in the 80s.
Yeah. Oh, wow.
90s.
Yeah.
And I saw them in the bar watching the support act. So I introduced myself to them and said that I was a big fan. And they said, "Oh, come backstage." And so I went backstage and I sat down talking for them for about 40 minutes, probably.
Wow, that must have been amazing for you.
It was. And I was up dancing all night, and they finished, and I was walked off the dance floor, and as I was walking off the dance floor, somebody tapped me on the shoulder, and I turned round, and it was Lee Brilleaux, the singer, and he had a harmonica, and he went, "You can play this, can't you? Do you want to do the encore with us?"
So is that where the name Brilleaux came from?
Yes.
Hmm.
That's where the name...
That was a question I was going to ask, and I'd forgotten to answer. I would have kicked myself if I hadn't asked that question. That's really good.
Yeah, that's the inspiration. Lee
Brilleaux.
And I called it Brilleaux. Right. Nobody in New Zealand was really aware of who Lee Brilleaux was, and it's quite a cool name.
Mm.
So I thought, it was just like a secret little, tribute
to
my favourite singer, like calling the band Howling Wolf or Rolling Stones, they're...
So back to the UK tour, standout feature?
Playing at... every gig is a standout.
Yeah. One particular memory, it doesn't have to be a gig, it could be...
We played at the Troubadour, which is in London, Earl's Court, which is a historic venue.
Mm.
Jimi Hendrix played there.
Mm.
All the people of, the legends of the 60s played in this little... underground bar.
Mm.
There's so much history in the walls.
Mm.
And so we got to play there. And we got to play, we had a special guest, Dave Bucket Colwell, who was like a session guitarist and who plays with Humble Pie. He plays for Bad Company. He took the place of Mick Ralphs on the guitar. And so we became friendly with Bucket, and he came and joined us at the Troubadour, and that's a huge, huge honour.
Yeah.
You know, we don't get to rub shoulders with those sort of legends of the international scene much.
Yeah.
There was another one, Steve Walwyn, the guitarist from Dr. Feelgood now.
Yeah.
And he came, put himself out of his way. To come and play at one of our shows with us, and that was a huge honour. We are blessed.
And also, just thinking about your Hawke's Bay house, tell us something about that, because that's an interesting project that you've got still on the go, I assume.
Yes, still on the go. Tauranga, we had a lovely house in Tauranga.
Mm, you did.
And we had a mortgage, as you do. And I just decided I'm getting older now and I just wanted to get rid of my mortgage. So we looked around the country at a cheaper place to live.
Yeah.
And we ended up, we went down to Hawke's Bay and we were going to buy a lifestyle block. And we couldn't find one that we liked. And we were looking in the window at some properties of a real estate. And there was a big old Art Deco building.
Right.
And I said, wow, that's a cool building. Where's that? And the real estate agent walked over to the window and pointed out across the road and said, it's right there. Would you like to go and have a look?
Wow.
Well, I love architecture.
Yeah.
And so I said, yes, I'd love to. So we had a tour of this old Art Deco bank and we just fell in love with it.
Yeah.
And the real estate agent said, well, that's not exactly a lifestyle block, is it? And we said, oh, we just couldn't buy a property like this in Tauranga. One, they don't exist because they knocked them all down. And two, is that we couldn't afford to do that in Tauranga. Mm. So yes, this will suit us nicely, thank you. We'll buy this one. So we bought it freehold.
Wow, and now you're doing it all up?
And I'm building a house inside of the bank.
Amazing.
Which is rather unusual.
Basically, anything you want to talk about first? You might want to say. You've done so much. Mind you, I couldn't have missed much, could I? Probably have.
No, we spoke about Richie, and that was a very important part of the musical history of Tauranga.
Yeah, definitely.
I say Richie, but it was Chris Gunn as well. They were like the Glimmer Twins, like Keith Richards and Mick Jagger. They were just inspirational. They lifted the level of music in this area. That's why the scene was so good, because we had these guys who were right up here, and they just inspired us to do better and play better and do better things. And they were a huge inspiration.
Where can we get your CDs and things from?
Usually you can buy Brilleaux CDs online at iTunes and Spotify, but the best place to get them is from us.
And your book?
A live show. You can get the book only from me, or actually books are plenty.
We've got your CDs,
yes.
We've got your merch, and your book. And where can we see Brilleaux playing in about, say, 6 months' time?
Well, I'm not sure about 6 months, but we have a completely booked out for February this year.
Yep.
And March is pretty full as well. We're working towards funding another UK tour, perhaps our last one. And this year, 2019, is the 20th anniversary of Brilleaux.
Wow.
Which is pretty unheard of for a local band. And so
congratulations.
Thank you.
And Brilleaux?
Yes, congratulations.
We would like to record it will be our 11th album.
Right.
We've recorded 10 albums, and so I think we've got enough impetus to produce at least one more and maybe get another UK tour.
Where do you think you'll record it?
We'll probably, once again, do it at Tim's.
Tim, I've seen some of them up on the wall.
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, Tim understands us. Tim is a master at what he does. He always contributes musically to us as well.
He does, yeah.
So he's invaluable. Tim is a very clever guy.
Well, thank you very much for coming on our show and letting us come actually with you in Totoro Street here, which is a great venue.
Yes.
And all the best for your show tonight with David Bowie. David Bowie's double.
Yeah.
And we'll look out and see if we can spot him, shall we, around the building.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I'm pretty loyal to my guitars too. Like, I don't go through a whole bunch of them. Yeah. The guitar I'm playing now is about 15 years I've had it.
Wow.
It's pretty beat up.
Are you one of these people that play that has names for the guitars?
Not really. I think I tried once, but it didn't stick with me. So I kind of gave up. I remember seeing Hard to Handle with Tippy.
Oh yeah, he's great. Up at
Cactus Jacks, I think it was. Yeah. Saint Amand up the top.
Like the writing process. How do you write? You know, like, do you just get your guitar and just kind of write along with some lyrics, or do you have a specific passion of writing, or the process of it?
Not really.
No.
No, I'll quite often find a riff that I kind of like, a riff, mm-hmm. you know, and then I'll try and put a vocal on it. And then whatever I kind of come up with after that is, I just roll with that.
Yeah. No one will.